We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered
death. Good morning. I am coming to you from my office today because we had some technical glitches in our morning service today with our recording. So this is why I'm coming from my office. I'm going to redo the message. So we want to begin this morning by looking at Romans chapter 12. And in Romans chapter 12, we've been talking about what is true worship. And true worship is bowing down and lifting up the one true God. We read Romans chapter 12 and verse 1, where it says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And today I want to talk about what these mercies of God is all about. In order to do that, we have to look at what is the therefore. And it's Paul's way of saying, what I said to you in the previous 11 chapters, these are the mercies of God. In context, as you look at it, there's five things that the Apostle Paul speaks about, and I want to share those with you here today. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 1, he says, let's look back. And so let's do this. In Romans chapter 1 through 3, we see that God's mercy is evident. It's unmistakable. It's obvious. In this passage, you notice in Romans chapter 2 and verse 4, he talks about people who despise the riches of his goodness and forbearance and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance. In Romans 1 and 2, the apostle Paul describes three different types of people. Those people that he's describing are people that are naturally sinners. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 18, it says that the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all who suppress the truth and unrighteousness. And he goes through a list of things that describes the perversions that mankind does in direct opposition of what God wants for their lives as he's created us to be. And so there's the natural sinner that has within his heart a desire to go the opposite direction of what God wants. And in Romans chapter 1, he describes the natural sinner. Jeremiah 17:9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. In verse 32 of chapter 1 of Romans, he describes them as having pleasure in perversion. So the natural sinner just naturally follows what his sinful nature will dictate to him to do. And then you'll notice he talks about the intellectual sinner. In Romans 2 and verse 15, he talks about that they go about by the light of their conscience, but not in submission to God. He describes the Gentiles. The word Gentile in the Greek language means ethnos. That's the word that is used there, and it's the word we get ethnic, different people throughout different cultures. They're different races. But he says the Gentiles, of all races of people, there are intellectual people of all these people, and they think that their intellectual pursuits make them acceptable to God, and that isn't true. The Bible is pretty clear about that. He says they serve God according to their conscience. The Gentiles do by nature the things that are in the law, these being a law unto themselves. And as a result, they think in their own pursuits they are morally righteous, and in reality, they're not. And then he describes in Romans 2 the religious sinner. He believes that because he keeps the law, particularly speaking about Jews, the cultural heritage of the ancient Jewish faith. There are those that they don't believe that it's by faith that they come to God. They believe that because they're born into this culture and because they have this tradition, they're okay with God. And that doesn't make people okay with God. The sacrifices of the Lord are a broken and a contrite heart thou wilt not despise, David said in Psalm 51. So we have these three different classes of sinners: the natural sinner that pursues whatever his flesh dictates to him, the intellectual sinner who thinks he's morally superior to others, and then there's the religious sinner that thinks he keeps the law and nobody else does. He's the only one that can do that. And Paul says, you're without excuse. Notice he says that it is not by our works that we're saved. The first three chapters point to that. There's none righteous, no, not one. God's mercy is seen in the fact that all of mankind is in the same situation, and God doesn't destroy all of mankind. Rather, he's long-suffering, and he wants them to come to him. His mercy is seen, secondly, in that God gives righteousness by faith and not by works. You'll notice in Romans chapter 4, verses 4 and 5, it says, now to those, the one who works, wages are not credited as a gift, but as an obligation. However, to the one who does not work but trusts God, who justifies the ungodly, their faith is credited for righteousness. Romans chapter 3 and verse 24, Paul says this, all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ. And in verse 25, he says, God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of blood to be received by faith. Now just think about this. God has created all. He's given us all talents and abilities that differ. Some can do things that other people can't do. These are all gifts, these abilities. Now, if God approves those who can achieve greater things because of their abilities, how would that be fair? For God to say, well, I'm going to judge you based upon what gifts that you use for me and whether or not you can come to me, that's not a fair way of judging people. God gives us abilities, and we think that what he gives us is what makes us acceptable. Nothing could be further from the truth. God's mercy is seen in the fact that faith is the vehicle for forgiveness. The fact that I exercise faith, that you exercise faith to believe in Jesus Christ, God's Son, is evidence of the fact that God is fair. Everybody's on a level playing ground. All of us have the ability to exercise faith. Not all of us have the ability to do complicated math equations. Not all of us have the ability to reach the top shelf of our kitchen cupboards. Some of us are shorter. Some of us are not gifted with abilities that other people have. But yet all of us have faith. All of us can exercise faith. In Romans 4:4, it says, now to the one who works, wages are not credited, but as a gift, an obligation. However, to the one who does not work but trust God, who justifies the ungodly, their faith is credited as righteousness. God's mercy is seen in the fact that he judges us based upon whether or not we exercise faith. Notice by the mercies of God, Paul is referring to a third thing, and that is, God loves the undesirable and undeserving. In chapters 4 and 5, we read, but God commends his love toward us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5:8 tells us very clearly that God loves us even though we are unlovely. And that's why he says in Romans 5:1, there is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. God loves the undesirable and undeserving, and we are justified by faith. We have peace with God. Number four, I want you to notice the mercies of God are seen in that God gives peace to his enemies. In chapter 7 and 8, Paul says, I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwells no good thing, for to will is present with me. But how to perform that which is good, I don't find it. For the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not do, that I do. Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwells in me. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. What Paul's describing is the fact of what he said in Romans 3:10, there's none righteous. Romans 3:23, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Sin causes us to miss the mark of what God has designed us to be. And our flesh dictates to us to do the things that are not in keeping with God's will. Paul lays out a list of 17 things in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 17. He says, the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, strife, wrath, factions, seditions, heresies. All of these things don't point themselves to God. They point away from God. And our sin nature causes us to pursue things that are not in keeping, that would establish our relationship with God. Now, Paul says at the end of this, I know I'm a sinful man. I want to do well. I want to do good. But I have this sin that easily besets me. I think that's why we read later on that we're to lay aside the sin that so easily besets us and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus in Hebrews chapter 12. But you notice in verse 25 of Romans 7, he says, I thank Christ Jesus my Lord, so that with my mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. What he's saying is, I'm never going to be perfect with this sinful body. I'm going to have this battle. I'm going to have this struggle to do what's right. But the answer to doing right is found just solely in surrendering to God and Jesus Christ in my life. And notice what he says in Romans 8:1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. When you came to faith in Christ and you received Jesus as your Savior, the Holy Spirit came to indwell you. And he speaks to you. And there's this battle that goes on. It's a civil war within every heart that is a believer in Jesus Christ. Will I do what God wants me to do when he speaks to me through his Spirit? Or will I do what my flesh dictates to me to do? And Paul says this is the struggle. But one of the things, the great things about God's mercy is the fact that he gives us the resources to combat this sin. Now notice number 5, God's mercy is given to us in a simple message that all can receive. Chapters 9 through 11, Paul talks about the gospel. All throughout this epistle, he's talking about the gospel. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 16, he says, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. And then over in chapter 10, he's describing God's mercy in the fact that he's bringing good news. He says later on in verse 17, I believe it is, how beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good tidings. He tells us in Romans 10:9 that if thou shalt confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And then he says in verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. God gives us all a simple message. Trust me, believe in me. If we were to go to theology class and you were to study in theology, one of the great things that we learn in theology is the fact that God is true. The Bible clearly says, yea, let God be true and every man a liar. And theologians refer to this as the veracity of God. My friend, God will never lie to you. He'll always tell you the truth. Contrary to the way that it is in the world today, even the closest of family members, the closest of friends find people that lie to them. But God will never lie to you. And you notice in Scripture it says in this passage that this is a message that all can receive. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You know, the word that is used for saved occurs over 40 times in the Greek New Testament. It means to lift up. God is lifting us up. You remember we talked about true worship is bowing down to the true God, the one true God, and then exalting and lifting him up. We see that in the words that are used for worship. Hallelujah is the word Hillel, the Hebrew word to mean to lift up. Jehovah, Yah is Jehovah. And in the New Testament, we have the Greek word proskuno, which means to bow the knee, to bow down. And we have the same thing in the Old Testament, in the New Testament, bowing down, lifting up the true God. Now, it's interesting when you do that with God, God will do that for you. He will lift you up. One of the great things that I saw in the Old Testament studying in the life of Jacob, Jacob was a twin. Jacob wanted his father's blessing, and he deceived to get it. And when he left the family because of the fact that the older brother was so angry that he had lied and cheated to get the blessing from the father, Jacob had to leave. And Jacob went out, and he ended up, the very things that he sowed, he reaped. His deception, people started lying and deceiving him. And finally, God had an encounter with him. He met the angel of the Lord, and they wrestled all night. And after they wrestled, God changed his name, and he gave him a new name. He called him Israel. The word Israel is a compound word in the Hebrew referring to fighting. Isra, to fight. Some have said that it is the word to mean prince, and that is true, but it has another meaning. That other meaning is that when you fight God, God fights you. When you fight for God, God will fight for you. And this is what happened in Jacob's life. And every believer, every person who comes to faith in Jesus Christ, you find out that when you surrender to God, God opens doors for you. It's a joy to know the Lord because you can see that God is at work. It is he that works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. My friend, if you accept by simple faith the Lord Jesus as your Savior, God will fight for you. Back in 1951, the Rosenbergs, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, were convicted of espionage and giving secrets to the Russians. The sentence was pronounced that they were guilty. And their lawyers argued very animatedly to try to get the judge to give them justice. They said, what my clients are asking for is for justice. Judge Kaufman replied calmly, the court has given you what you asked for. You asked for justice. What you really want is mercy. And it's interesting to note that in today's world, many people are crying out for justice, when in reality, what they need is mercy, because all of us are guilty. Before God, how many people, I think, today are angry at God and they're bitter toward God? And God says, okay, I understand you're bitter and you're angry. We read in 2 Peter chapter 3, God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. This simple message, to believe by faith, God in his age of grace today is preaching a message, trust me, trust me, trust me. And everybody's saying, no, I want to do it my way. I don't want to do it your way. They're kind of singing the tune of Frank Sinatra, I did it my way. Well, my friend, true worship of God is acknowledging his mercies. Lamentations 3:26 says, God's mercies are new every day. Great is his faithfulness. It's been said that many kings and monarchs, if you look at the history of the world, are mean-spirited and cruel to their subjects. King Richard III, the story is told of him where he came back from a battle and he had been out examining the battlefield and he was coming back to his encampment and he saw one of his sentries in the early hours of dusk sleeping. And he went over to the man and he pulled out his dagger and stabbed the man and killed him and put a note on the dagger that said, I found him sleeping. That's how I'm going to leave him. He did that, I think, to instill fear within his soldiers not to fall asleep. That's pretty cruel. I can assure you, my friends, God is a great king. God is sovereign. He controls and owns everything. He owns you. He owns me. He's going to judge this world. But I can tell you, he will be fair. And he's loving in the midst of all this. Even though people are cursing his name, he loves you. You'll find that he's long-suffering and kind. If you surrender your heart to him, he will do you good all your days, all the days of your life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. I hope you know him and you're living for him and serving him with your life. Till we meet again, God bless you. And
we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit.